Morning, everyone. It's nice to see some faces that I haven't seen in a long time again. But I'll maybe take a step back before I jump into the heart of the presentation, which is to evaluate South Africa's level of foreign debt. So before I get into that, I'll say that South Africa, like many other developing countries, have had growing levels of external debt following the COVID-19 pandemic in order to finance social relief packages, or at least that was the argument that was made at the time. And this increased borrowing has, of course, put pressure on public finances within developing countries. And since then, we've seen the culmination of many, in fact, having to implement austerity economic policies as a means to ameliorate growing debt levels. And this, of course, comes within a much bigger context where all countries need to embark on a process to decarbonize its energy systems, whilst also hopefully contributing to improving socioeconomic conditions while doing so as part of a just transition. And besides just the energy component, this in general would require large levels of resources. And the question then is, on the back of rising debt levels, particularly foreign debt denominated in foreign currency, where is the potential space for the resources to be, where can the resources be harnessed to invest in such a so-called just transition? And this must take into account, of course, that to finance a transition through greater levels of borrowing could pose potential risks that may undermine transitioning to low carbon economies in a way that also tries to mitigate deep socioeconomic inequities. So it's within that context then that I thought, okay, let's evaluate South Africa's debt levels. And when you look at total national government debt, what you would see is that foreign loans in and of itself makes up quite a small percentage of total national or gross loan debt, just under 12%. And this is often argued to be a very favorable position in that it indicates that most of South Africa's borrowings is in rands, which opens up possibilities of how that debt can be financed. But this doesn't give us a full picture. What we need to look at is the total external debt and the percentage of total external debt that's denominated in foreign exchange. Now, at the latest South African Reserve Bank estimate, which is of 31 December 2022, South Africa has a total gross external debt of about $164 billion. Of this, approximately $90 billion, which is just about 55%, is denominated in foreign exchange, hard foreign currency, which is quite significant and substantial. And this comprises of public enterprises, SOEs, and various other state institutions borrowing from commercial and private institutions, including IFIs. One example will be spoken about in one of the sessions, which is the turn to the World Bank loan. And Basani, I think, also addresses the issue of the jet fees. So over the past period, there's also been growing levels of borrowings from international finance institutions. And a lot of it has been justified on the basis of climate finance. And this is where the issue of the jet IP comes in. However, this whole system is not just about IFIs, it's about, or the JETP in particular, it's about the logic of financing. Included in the growing debt levels, and an important aspect that must be taken into consideration, is the usage of the sale of domestic bonds to non-resident investors. And this, in a way, is a debt. And while the levels of domestic bonds owned by non-resident bondholders have declined, they are still quite substantial at around a quarter of total domestic bonds. And what this then requires is government will have to repay interest on these or to these non-resident bondholders. And this is also has to be paid back in foreign exchange. So this is the big issue about borrowing and why there's sometimes a turn to borrowing and how I think we can assess the kind of needs of borrowing in the one sense, which relates to in the immediate term, it's a question of what levels of foreign exchange you have and what possibilities you have to raise foreign exchange in the future to cover debt service costs. And sometimes the argument is that we need to borrow in order to cover debt service requirements because we don't have adequate levels of foreign exchange reserves. Now, what we have seen is that there has been a decline in the level of foreign exchange reserves from all-time highs in 2020, where it's now sitting at around $46 billion, if I remember offhand correctly, as of December 2022. Now, in spite of the massive decline, when you look at our import costs, we are able to cover import costs for about 4.9 months. Now, the South African Reserve Bank's threshold says that you want sufficient foreign exchange reserves to at least cover 3 months import costs and debt service costs. So in terms of that metric, we're relatively okay. There's no immediate threat. But of course, as you increase borrowings from IFIs, you also increase the need to raise greater levels of foreign exchange. Now, this can occur through a variety of ways. The one way is through exports, okay? And of course, we export a range of commodities, and this does bring in quite substantial levels of revenue. It underpins our economy, and it's the perpetuation of the dependence on the mineral energy extractivism complex. I lose my train of thought, sorry. So that's the one way, through exporting goods. And the more we export goods and the more we dependent on this paradigm, it obviously has implications in relation to investing in the creation of a local and domestic economy. And it's an impediment to a reindustrialization program that can lead to large levels of job creation. Another way through which we can attract foreign exchange reserves is through the financial markets. And this is through the domestic bond market, the selling of government bonds. And yeah, this is basically having to show that your interest rate is more competitive than other interest rates in the global economy to incentivize so-called investors to purchase your bonds. And this is in a context where there's massive inequalities in relation to interest rates, where and a greater attraction, for example, to US bonds. And in the context where there's rising repo rates globally, this has at least two major implications. The one is that South Africa and other developing economies have to dramatically increase domestic interest rates to try and ameliorate the loss in financial outflows from the capital account, as bondholders sell off South African bonds in order to purchase, for example, US bonds. This high interest rate will have other repercussions that I would address slightly later. How much time do I have left? 5 more minutes. Okay. Let me speed up. So we have to then have this high interest rate regime, which also stifles the ability of domestic or local businesses from advancing greater levels of productivity due to higher borrowing costs. So it mitigates against the generation of local economies. There's another way of attracting foreign exchange. But anyway, so you attract this foreign exchange through this kind of export-led growth path, coupled with increasing financialized markets and the deregulation of the capital market. Now, just very quickly, besides this kind of locking into this paradigm, there's also a number of immediate threats that's faced in terms of turning to greater levels of borrowing in foreign currency. So the first one relates to exchange rate volatility. And just like the differences in inequities between interest rates, similarly exchange rates too, it's connected on the same basis. And here, again, developing countries and South Africa has a weaker nominal effective exchange rate in comparison to major economies. And over the past year, for example, the rand depreciated immensely in terms of the dollar, the pound, and the euro. This directly increases the costs, the capital costs of the loan, and the interest rates that we are in a high interest rate economy, as it increases as well, also puts greater pressure on debt servicing costs. So this, as I was saying, puts immediate pressure on the country to raise this foreign exchange reserves and all the macroeconomic implications related to this, including in terms of industrial policy. Three, as your exposure to foreign exchange grows and your debt requirements grow, it also poses the risk of credit rating downgrades. And I know we can problematize this, which I agree we ought to do, but it's the paradigm we are in. So we have to face it as in the reality, you know. And the minute you have downgrades, it's a kind of vicious cycle, which also then means greater costs of borrowing in the future and puts the possibility of a debt default in greater probability, and this has major socioeconomic implications once it does unfold. And of course, it has a range of fiscal and monetary constraints, like this high interest rate policy, austerity, and so on. So, I mean, I think that when we look at it on the balance, what we see is that our exposure to foreign exchange is significant and a concern. To turn to greater levels of foreign exchange or borrowing from IFIs pose a number of major risks, and that if we look at it in the context of what our current foreign exchange requirements are, there seems to be less of a need to turn to IFIs. And I think that when we put it in the context of which I was hoping to spend a little bit of time on, but I ran out of time, is that South Africa has a range of potential financing options to embark on the transitionary aspect, including through borrowing domestically, as in rands, as opposed to in foreign exchange, or pathways that we can do. And so not only is it not necessary, I would argue that it's probably undesirable in the context that we are in. And probably the main reason behind turning to more IFIs, besides the need, of course, for, and this is where I end, the need to cover, the argument is to cover debt service costs, is why they're borrowing to pay back debt. And I think that's something many of us can get more and more familiar with. And that's a trap. It's a big trap that we want to avoid. And then when we look at the alternatives, the reason why is I think that it's a thin cloak or a thin fig leaf for the advancement of green structural adjustment programs and neoliberal austerity, which is, I think, where Basani will take it forward. Thank you.